A very good morning and welcome to the second joint meeting in 2023 of members of the Criminal Justice, the Health, Social Care and Sport and the Social Justice and Social Security Committees to consider the progress made in implementing the recommendations of the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force. So we have apologies this morning from Paul O'Kane, who is attending a meeting of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. And before we begin, I wish to place on record our thanks to Claire Hawhey and Sue Webber for visiting Aberlour Mother and Child Unit on our behalf and for the helpful note that they provided of their meeting. And I'd also like to thank Aberlour for facilitating that visit and express our particular thanks to the two women who took the time to speak about their personal experiences. We're very, very grateful. So our first item of business is to decide whether to take item three in private, which is a review of today's evidence. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. So our next item of business is an evidence session on tackling drug deaths and drug harm. And I'm pleased to welcome our first panel of witnesses today. They are Kirsten Horsburgh, Chief Executive Officer, and Wes Steele, Senior Training and Development Officer with the Scottish Drugs Forum. Simon Rayner, Service Lead at Aberdeen Alcohol and Drug Partnership, and Tracy McFall, Chairperson of the Scottish Recovery Commission. So warm welcome to you all. And I refer members to papers one and two, and I thank witnesses who provided written submissions. So we'll move straight to questions, and as ever, I will open up. Just perhaps to help set the scene and get some discussion underway. So I'd like to perhaps ask individual members of the panel just their sort of broad response in relation to the statistics on drug-related deaths. So there's been a lot of commentary and coverage of drug-related death statistics. The most recent publication of the annual drug-related death statistics shows a decline. However, the figures published by the National Records of Scotland found that 1,051 people died due to drug misuse in 2022, which was a decrease compared to 2021 and the lowest annual total since 2017. However, we know drug death numbers remain stubbornly high. So I wonder if I can perhaps just ask individual members what their response is and what commentary they might have around the recent statistics for drug-related deaths. Do you feel that we've perhaps started to turn a bit of a corner? So maybe come to Kirsten first and then we'll work across the panel. Kirsten.
Thank you. Does that automatically come on? Yeah, thank you very much for having me. I think we were obviously welcoming the news that there had been a slight reduction in the numbers of drug-related deaths. Much better, of course, than the numbers going up. Mm-hmm. However, still over 1,000 people who've died from a preventable death. Still over 1,000 families, communities affected. And, you know, if we count those numbers up over the years, the numbers of lives that have been lost is just totally unacceptable. So we would like to think that some of the things that have been put in place are making an impact, but it's impossible to say that after only 1 year of a small reduction in the numbers. So and looking at the police suspected drug deaths for the start of this year as well, you know, we would need to see 3 to 5 years of the deaths coming down to know that what we were doing was really making an impact. And I think the issue itself gets described as a public health emergency. And the frustration that we have is around the urgency of that. You know, we talk about an emergency, but we don't really see a true emergency response. So there are things that are good that have been introduced, such as the medication-assisted treatment standards. But those need to be rolled out much more rapidly and need to be meeting the needs of everybody. So still lots more for us to do. Obviously, welcome news to see a slight reduction, but nowhere near enough that's needed. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Kirsten. Wes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the invite for coming today. I would echo pretty much everything that Kirsten's just said. I do think, You know, obviously we welcome the reduction. I think it's way too early to say that it's a downward trend. I would like to see a much more substantial reduction over many more years to classify it as a kind of downward trend. I'm very apprehensive of what might be around the corner for us in regarding substance use in Scotland. We have seen small amounts of more toxic drugs in our drug supply, and I am personally quite worried that if we see more of these substances being present and we haven't got things like a safe drug consumption room available to more people than will be available to just with the Glasgow pilot. Drug check-in, I think, could help reduce the harms of these substances too. We still see a real strong prevalence of street benzodiazepines implicated in the drug-related deaths. And again, until I think we address this issue and give people much more adequate support as a wraparound alongside medication, I think we're still fighting an uphill battle, to be honest. And I think 2.7 times the death rate of the rest of the UK is still massively unacceptable for Scotland, and we can do much better.
Thanks for that, Wes. Simon Rayner.
Morning, thank you. I would echo much of what's been said. Aberdeen was an area in 2022 that had a reduction in drug deaths, but still 42 people died. In 2023, in terms of suspected deaths, then there is still a lot of concern about the numbers that are being presented in Aberdeen currently. So I don't expect that decrease to be continued this year. So there's that huge variable about the substances that people are taking. It doesn't take very much in a place the size of Aberdeen for, you know, a significant number of people to be affected very quickly. So I have concerns that despite all the things that we have done and all the things we haven't managed to do yet, we did manage to see a bit of reduction, but that that variable in terms of the supply side of substances is really dangerous, though.
Yeah. Thanks very much. And we'll maybe come back to some of the underlying factors that are helping see that slight decrease. Tracy.
Good morning, committee, and thanks for the invite. Yeah, I will echo everything my colleagues have said in relation to drug-related deaths. I don't think we are out of the woods yet in relation to the trends. I think 1 year is very early days in relation to the downward trend, and obviously the police stats show potentially an upward trend. A couple of anomalies for me, though. In terms of some of the statistics, there was 474 people which had methadone implicated in their deaths. We need to understand if those people were in treatment. Because actually, are those 474 deaths, were those people who bought methadone from the street, or were those people in treatment? So I think there's a wee bit of more work we have to do underneath the statistics. Now, I spoke to Public Health before coming to the committee, and we've not recorded some of those statistics nationally for some time. Locally, you will find those in the drug-related death review groups. But if we are talking about potential consumption rooms, heroin-assisted treatment, different treatments that should be protective, then we need to understand if those people are dying in treatment, why that is. So there's a couple of anomalies in the stats, and also a big one for Scottish Recovery Consortium is cocaine use. There's an increase in cocaine use, and potentially we don't have an antagonistic approach, potentially, where you have methadone and opiates. That's about wraparound support, psychological support. So this is just bigger than treatment. We need to think about the broader wraparound support that people need in relation to psychological support. So that was the two standouts for me at early days. But those were kind of standouts for me in terms of different trends emerging from the drug-related death statistics.
Thanks very much. I don't know, Colette Stevenson, did you want to come in just with a follow-up and then we'll move on?
Yeah. Thanks very much, and a very good morning to all of you. Basically, you know, we talk about the drug deaths and drug usage here in Scotland and how high it is in comparison to the rest of even Europe. Do you feel that we should be looking at that more closely and like carry out more research as to why Scotland is higher? I'll put that to Tracy first of all. Thanks.
Yeah, I mean, Scotland is very different from other countries in many respects, and we do know some of the underlying factors in relation to drug-related deaths, and that's about poverty, it's about depending where you live in the country, depending whether you've got opportunities, depending whether you've been through adverse childhood experiences, depending whether you've had trauma. So there is actually quite a body of evidence out there already to actually give us a sense of actually what causes people to use alcohol and drugs. I think more broadly, though, I do think as a country we need to look at some of those cross-cutting pieces. I mean, if you look at the justice system, and I know the Justice Committee, and I know you're the convener of the Justice Committee, but if you look at mental health, justice, and in our submission we talked about the Hard Edges report, we have loads, thousands of people in Scotland bouncing around mental health, addictions, justice services, domestic violence and homelessness. There's something we can do in that to join those dots. One, potentially, there's not a big pot of money at the end of the rainbow, so we might save some money if we look at this as a whole system. But we need to start joining the dots. We need to take every single opportunity, at every single intervention point where people are coming in touch with services. And that no wrong door approach is absolutely critical. So I think we could do more research, and I think that would be absolutely fantastic. But we do know the underlying causes of why people use drugs. So that's about poverty, trauma, where you come from, lack of opportunities, lack of hope. And it's very difficult to get off that merry-go-round once you're in that. But we need to join the dots, Colette. We really do. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Just quickly, can I come in on that? You touched upon like methadone as well as a cause of, you know, drug-related overdoses as well. Is that a combined thing? I just wanted to draw that out.
Well, we don't know. Methadone has been implicated in 474 deaths. We don't know whether those people were in treatment, and that's my question around. We really need to dig a wee bit deeper around, because if people are dying, what implicated methadone in their deaths, is that because they're buying it from the street, or is that because they were actually in treatment? So that's one of the reasons why I think we really need to get underneath some of these stats. And I think that's why we need to dig a wee bit deeper in relation to the local drug-related death reviews and what that looks like nationally.
Okay, thanks, Tracy. Simon, I don't know if you want to come in on that.
In terms of the research, I think research is always helpful and always good. I think we probably fall into a little bit of a trap in terms of thinking as Scotland as a homogenous unit. We've got extreme poverty and extreme rurality. I think there is obviously, by the nature of the parliament and politicians and major organisations being in the central belt, that there is often a focus on a lot of the harm that goes on there. But I think we need to think about different ways of tackling it. Not all drug-related deaths are, you know, a single substance these days. It's multiple different substances, and we need different approaches to tackle that.
Thanks, Simon. Wes, would you like to come in?
Thank you. I think I prefer to see additional resources put towards helping us in this public health emergency that we're in, rather than researching the drivers and the underlying causes, if I'm honest. I think there needs to be a more immediate response to helping the people that are struggling and are at the most risk of drug-related harms right now. That's just my kind of personal opinion. Just super quickly, if I may, on the methadone being implicated, I would hazard a guess that it's really going to be low numbers where it is only methadone. It's always going to be polydrug use. It's going to be use in combination. And I do think we know some of the drivers. We might not have, you know, gold standard evidence to suggest exactly what it is, but I think access to treatment, difficulty in people accessing treatment, I think we know is one of the drug drivers of the drug-related deaths in Scotland, and I'd prefer to see resources go into helping people get support that they need.
Okay. Thank you. And finally, Kirsten. Thanks.
Thanks. Yeah, I would agree that I think we know what the drivers of problem drug use are, so it wouldn't make sense to continue to research that. I think we should be expending our efforts on introducing and action in all the recommendations that have been made from numerous bodies on this topic. One thing I just wanted to add about individual drug deaths and substances is that, particularly in relation to methadone, we know generally from the drug death database report that comes out every other year is that it's around 50% of people who are dying from a with methadone in their system that was in treatment at that time. It used to be quite higher proportions who were not in treatment, and now it's sort of levelled out, so it would be interesting to see more up-to-date figures on that. But the reality is, with individual substances that are being found in the bodies, it's very difficult to dig into that in too much detail because it's very open to interpretation by the individual forensic pathologists that are involved in that post-mortem and doing that analysis. So we tend to try not to focus too much on the individual substances and those trends, but realise that the majority of people who die have died because they have taken multiple substances.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I was going to move on to the sort of cross-government action plan, but I think there's a lot to cover, so if we've got time, I'll come back to that. So I will move on now to some questions around safe consumption rooms, no surprise. I'm going to bring in Sue Webber, and then I'll bring in Katie Clark. So, Sue.
Thank you, Convener. I thought we were maybe doing MAT standards first, but that's fine. I was falling through. But that's okay. Don't worry. I'll maybe get a chance to come on that. We know the Lord Advocates provided some evidence on the legalities of the drug consumption room that's been specified for Glasgow. But I suppose I'm, in terms of that bigger picture, you know, I'm wondering how do you know how logistically, if any of you got any idea how logistically it will work on the ground in terms of that aspect? I'm looking, Kirsten, unfortunately, you're nodding the most fervently, so perhaps we can come to you first.
Thanks, Sue. And yeah, I mean, obviously, I've been interested in the subject of safer drug consumption rooms for some time. And initially, I was on the Short Life Working Group in Glasgow for when they were introducing the proposal for this facility way back in 2016. We've said and advocated for some time that we feel like the Lord Advocate would be in a position to provide a prosecution waiver to allow these facilities to exist. So it's great that that is now finally happening, although we do have concerns about some of the restrictions that will be in place because of there's not a change to the Misuse of Drugs Act. So there will be some restrictions in terms of how they can operate. But my understanding from the Glasgow service is that it's already been identified where the site will be, and it will be in the same building as the heroin-assisted treatment is, or the enhanced drug treatment service at the moment. It's likely the service will operate from 9 till 9. It will be open 365 days a year. It will be available to anyone in that locality who is injecting drugs. My understanding is it won't be an inhalation facility because of some of the restrictions. So, yeah, I mean, we really welcome this news. The anxiety about it is that we don't want to see a situation where we have one facility introduced in Glasgow that prevents anywhere else in Scotland from opening until the service is evaluated. So we would want to make sure that there wasn't a long, lengthy evaluation period that was then going to prevent other areas who were absolutely in need of introducing similar services, and that the model that's introduced in Glasgow wouldn't be setting the precedent for every model that had to be introduced across Scotland. So it's important when we are introducing these facilities that we have lots of different types. So we could have mobile units, we could have fixed site units, we could have just a room within an area that's already providing needle exchange facilities. So yeah, I would hope that we could not delay other areas by introducing this one.
So there was a couple of things on the back of that. In terms of the evaluation, I'd be interested to know if you know how and what methods are going to be used to evaluate the service. But also, a lot's been said that this will be the opportunity to engage with people and get people into treatment. So I'm curious about the level of support, what other services will be available in that environment. I'm not sure. Tracy and yourself might be best to answer these. So.
Yeah, so they've introduced, or they will be introducing an extensive community engagement and consultation period as well in terms of the service for local businesses, local partners, etc., and also, of course, with people who would benefit from using the service. I'm just trying to remember what
my question was about how are you going to evaluate it, but also, I mean, if the consultation comes back saying that none of the local businesses want it there, what are we going to do? It'll be another one. So it was more about the evaluation to determine the success and what's worked well, etc., and also what other services would be in there, the signposting aspect of things.
I don't know the exact detail of the evaluation, but I know that our partners and colleagues are working on that, and have got sort of a long way down the line with what will be evaluated from other countries. They have evaluated things like engagement in other services, like reductions in bloodborne virus transmission, like reductions in drug-related deaths. So there'll be, you know, it won't differ too much from the international evidence base around how they evaluate. So there'll be all these things that are looked at. The biggest bonus for having these types of facilities and the biggest evidence base is around the more somebody attends a facility like this, the more likely they are to then engage with other wraparound services. So that will be key for the service as well, to make sure that people can be linked into treatment services, that there will be services there for bloodborne virus treatment, there will be wound care, there will be all sorts of wraparound services attached to the
service. That's a lot of harm reduction, but I'm looking for maybe recovery services.
Well, I mentioned treatment there as well, so I did say that people would be accessing, able to access treatment services as part of that. But there shouldn't be an expectation if somebody attends a drug consumption room that the absolute end goal is abstinence. And I think that's key for this. Like, we can't turn the drug death crisis into a conversation about how we get everyone drug-free.
I'm not doing that.
And it's just about how we make sure that people are not judged, that they're given an option to connect with people in a way that they haven't been able to through any other service provision, and that they make their own choices about what's best for them and their quality of life. And goals like abstinence absolutely should be on the table, but that should never be, you know, promoted to people as that should be where you're heading. It shouldn't be entirely up to the individual.
Okay, thanks very much. Katie Clark, and then I'll bring in Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Convener. And the witnesses will have had the opportunity to look at the Lord Advocate's statement, and I wonder whether they believe that the scope of the Lord Advocate's recent statement in relation to drug consumption rooms, and in particular any potential criminal offences, is sufficient, or have they got any concerns that staff or others may not have the reassurance that they need to be involved in this kind of initiative? Maybe, I don't know if Tracy would be interested in coming in.
Yeah, key to this is going to be Police Scotland in relation to how this is managed and how this is policed. So, and I think we have to go through this process and see what that's going to look like. But if the direction has been given by the Lord Advocate, then I would hope that all of us as a society, all of us locally, then actually we want to try and see if this option works. So I don't necessarily, SRC don't have any necessarily have any concerns. I think we need to see how this is going to work in practice. What I do know in terms of our experience in SRC, my experience in working in the sector is, and I think it touches on what Kirsten said, is if someone is in real chaos and they're buying their street drugs in an area, it's very unlikely that they're going to go onto two buses to get to an injecting facility and a safe consumption room. So we need to be really careful in relation to, as Kirsten said, what that looks like, get the pilot up and running, but what does that look like in local areas? Where are the hot spots? But I would hope that our colleagues in Police Scotland, underlining by the Lord Advocate's letter, will actually do what it says in the tin. And that's about not criminalising people when they're in or near that facility. And just to touch on another point in terms of wraparound services in relation to the heroin-assisted, in relation to the consumption rooms, there is some learning we can look at. The heroin-assisted treatment facility in Glasgow has been evaluated, and there was some real learning in that in relation to some limitations in relation to the learning, but other things that we can maybe learn from in relation to the safer consumption facility. So a lack of non-dedicated medical staff. We need third sector in here. We need third sector to look at that broader recovery, housing, mental health support. The location of the service was critical to the people who used the heroin-assisted treatment because it was hard to get to. COVID had an impact on that as well. People had to walk through areas where there's high drug use to get to. So these are all things that we should be looking at and learning from in relation to the drug consumption facility. It was over-clinical. The people who talked to the research team said it was over-clinical. It's very difficult to get a drug consumption room to be trauma-informed, and I don't mean nice couches and fluffy carpets, but we really need to take on board some of the learning that people who have used this facility have told us. And actually, the high turnover of staff had a real implication in the relationships that people built. So, yes, the more people come into the facility, the more chance they will engage with services over time. but there needs to be consistency in staff to create those relationships. And those recovery conversations need to be every single part of that journey. So that was just to kind of contextualise that. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah. And on the issue of the Lord Advocate's statement and the way it's been drafted, do any of the other witnesses have any concerns, or do they think it provides sufficient comfort to enable this to go ahead? I'll bring in Kirsten.
Yeah, I think it was interesting to see that wording that was specifically about people who were accessing the service would not be charged for possession of drugs, and there was no mention around the staffing. And my understanding is that Glasgow is covering that aspect of it to ensure that the staff providing the service are protected. So I don't see any concerns. Glasgow certainly wouldn't be proceeding with it if they felt that there was any concerns for people who were staffing the service or people who were involved in the running of it at all. So I think it's okay. I think obviously ideally, if there was a change to the Misuse of Drugs Act, that would make things better for the rest of the UK as well, to be able to open up the doors a bit further. However, I think it's sufficient for what's been proposed.
We'll be moving on to that.
Thank you.
OK, thanks very much. Before I bring in Paul Sweeney, I wonder if I can just pick up, Tracy, you mentioned challenges around the high turnover of staff. I wonder if it might be helpful just at this point to sort of look at that a wee bit and maybe expand on that. I'll maybe come back to you, Tracy, and then I'll maybe bring in Simon Rayner on that.
Yeah, I mean, I could send, I think, I don't know if I sent the committee the link to the heroin-assisted treatment evaluation, but working in a heroin-assisted treatment facility and the pressures within that did create NHS high turnover of staff. There's not a lot of detail in the evaluation about why that was, but I think that's certainly a question that we need to ask ourselves when we go in to start to develop a safe consumption facility, because burnout, trauma the staff are seeing, there's an opportunity here to actually take some learning from that, convener. So I don't know the detail, but I can certainly send a link to the evaluation. That's a question for our NHS colleagues.
Thank you. That would be welcome. And if I can maybe just, I see you wanting to come in 2 seconds. I'll maybe come to Simon, maybe just to get some commentary about perhaps other issues that are impacting on staff turnover.
Sure. So I'm also a service manager in our local area. So day in, day out, working with frontline staff, in particular third sector and nursing and clinical staff working in this area. I would say that our staff are all working in this area because they want to help and they want to make a difference. I think there are systemic problems in terms of the workforce. There is no sort of professional structure, no professional qualification to work in the addictions field. There's lots of additional add-on bits of training that people can do post-qualifying. In terms of recruitment, there are particular challenges in the northeast in terms of nursing staff and medical staff and psychologists. I appreciate my colleague's sort of view on the third sector, and absolutely third sector and lived experience need to be core to our workforce, but the fundamental bit around drug consumption stabilisation and MAT standards is that there is a clinical element to be provided. So in terms of drug consumption rooms, I mean, these facilities in whatever shape or form they manifest themselves in Scotland, they can't afford to fail, and they need to be safe for the public and they need to be safe for staff and people using them. So I think there needs to be, in my view, a more sort of considered view on the structure of addiction services or addiction support for people in Scotland. We have an estimated 60,000 people with problematic substance use and 20,000 people in treatment. We need to vastly scale up and make this an attractive place for people to work in. The pressure that staff feel day in, day out in terms of delivering the MAT standards, reducing drug deaths, people feeling it's their fault, that they're not working hard enough to challenge these things, causes the burnout and the stress and the trauma for people. But we need to turn that round and have a workforce. I know there's a working group looking at workforce, but it needs something more about increasing the number of staff working in this area and wanting to work in this area.
Thanks very much. Very quickly,
it's very briefly. It's just in Edinburgh, we're very close to the access place where we are here. And I know from correspondence from people that work in there again, recognising how much they're committed to it. But having prescribers available is one of the biggest issues. Is that something that you recognise, Simon?
Absolutely. There's sort of innovation around non-medical prescribing, which is great. But certainly in the North East, I mean, there is just a deficit of nursing and medical staff wanting to work in this area. It might be different in the Central Belt. People can move around, etc.
But
a band 5 nurse, you know, is not going to relocate to the northeast of Scotland. And nurses can earn more in wards doing shifts and things like that. So there needs to be a fundamental, you know, if we're going to be innovative and aspirational around drug consumption rooms, you know, and all the other stabilisation facilities and all the other things that we should be doing in terms of an emergency response, we need to have an infrastructure. We can't just keep firefighting and stitching things together. There needs to be that well-considered plan and structure and aspiration for the future, that we've got a workforce that's properly trained, properly supported, properly invested in and properly rewarded for the work that they do, and not sort of blamed for the drug death figures when they're all trying their best to do the right thing.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bring in Paul Sweeney now.
Thanks, Kavir, and thanks to the panel for your contribution so far. The Minister for Drugs and Alcohol has said that the overdose prevention pilot in Glasgow will be limited to some extent, clearly by the Lord Advocate's guidance, the constraints imposed by the 1971 Act, but also potentially the issue being the design of the facility. So do the panel have a view on whether the pilot, being a higher threshold access, could hamper its efficacy, bearing in mind that the enhanced drug treatment service in Glasgow is only available to people who are already engaged with the homeless addictions team and was only designed to scale up to around a maximum of 40 persons using the facility on a regular basis? Do you believe that there's potential constraints?
Perhaps Wes Steele, would you like to come in first just to kick that off?
Thank you. I'd like to think that the drug consumption room is going to be piloted and evaluated, and I'm hoping that that will open the door to lower threshold services, and I think people would find it more acceptable to go to maybe a third sector provider. I'd love to see it rolled out in homeless accommodation. I've got a background in homelessness, and I think that some of the work we're seeing with a high tolerance in these services, you know, people are already living there, they're already using there or around there potentially, I think would increase the uptake and the acceptability of people. I think it will be a barrier, if I'm honest. I think a high clinical presence and the high threshold potentially will put people off, but I think, you know, it needs to be piloted, it needs to be evaluated and evidenced that it is safe to do, and then I would love to see us really drop that threshold. We see some really good practice in places like Canada, where it's people with lived and living experience that are actually facilitating and, you know, running these overdose prevention sites.
Thanks for that. Is there any other thoughts on that and just the initial stages and...
This is what I was, I guess, trying to hint at earlier in terms of the different models that are required. I don't think it would be fair to describe this as a high threshold model. I think it's quite different from the enhanced drug treatment service, where it is very high threshold given the nature of the prescribing there. So I think that it will be a much more open door policy for the drug consumption facility element of it. I do think there are going to be some restrictions just in terms of what the Lord Advocate's put in place, in terms of what's been felt to be within the Lord Advocate's gift to be able to do. Perhaps things like it being attached to another service, or, you know, and that sort of clinical element of it. And I think ideally we do want to see much more fluidity around how these services are operated. So we have numerous outlets for providing injecting equipment to people, fully in the knowledge that when we provide that equipment, they may well nip round the corner and inject in a close or in an abandoned building or in a car park or under a bridge in really unhygienic, undignified, unsafe conditions. So we would really like to see in the future, a strategy where any place who was providing injecting equipment also had a space where people could use if their alternative was going to be in one of those types of environments. So I think we can't be setting a precedent that's too high for the rest of Scotland and putting off other areas from introducing these facilities thinking that they're going to cost millions of pounds. Mm. And we absolutely need to have that flexibility in how they're delivered going forward.
Mm. I think that's helpful. And I did note that the initial heroin assisted treatment pilot in Glasgow was a capital spend of 1.2 million, which did suggest it wasn't scalable to a great extent beyond a fairly limited network. Though, in contrast, there's 45 needle exchanges in Glasgow currently, so that maybe shows the scale in which we could potentially move towards. Is there any other thoughts on where this could evolve to?
I think having as many different methods of trying to roll this out. I mean, I suppose the key principle is that people have somewhere safe, clean, hygienic and monitored to use substances, which has not been available to them because of the stigma and the criminality associated with substance use. So for me, the drug consumption room is one way of doing that. I think we need to think about other ways of providing that environment for people. But I do think it will cost millions of pounds to do it properly and safely.
I could ask just about the... So there will be a co-location with the heroin-assisted treatment service. What would the interface for that be like? Obviously, one of the big challenges with street injection is purchasing uncontrolled substances of unknown toxicity, dosage, etc. Will there be an effort to try and actually encourage people to substitute street-bought drugs for a prescribed alternative that would be safer and more controlled?
I can't answer that. That's a Glasgow question.
Fair enough. Is there anyone that might have an insight on that potential interface?
Kirsten can maybe come in after me, but you would hope that there's a pathway that we could provide in relation to that treatment facility. And as Kirsten said, that people who are injecting unsafely have maybe not engaged the services for a very long time. They will take a lot to build up that relationship for them to come onto that treatment pathway, but you would hope there's a treatment pathway that would help people come through to more safer injecting, more safer use, but actually onto treatment and then potentially recovery. Just a couple of very quick points in terms of what you said earlier. So we need to make sure that we're not assuming as professionals here that we know what people need in this facility. So we need to make sure that lived experience is driving this. And that was very clear in the Drug Desk Task Force. This should not be service-centric. It needs to be service user-centric. So we need to remember there's people in this and we need to ask them what they need. In terms of how are we going to know it's working, we need the evaluation to be very agile. We need the evaluation to be evaluating quickly and making changes quickly in relation to those thresholds. Thresholds generally create exclusion. So that's why we need the evidence base to be very agile so we can adapt and shift. And if we're looking at, and that's really, really important because this is about early intervention and prevention. This is about saving people's lives. So there's loads in this. But the big thing for me is when we start the evaluation in this, it needs to be agile. We need to make sure it's real time, if possible, and we need to shift and change depending on what the different needs are. Paul, so I hope that answers.
That's very helpful. There was just one more thing I wanted to ask. Obviously, Mr. Steele had mentioned Canada as an interesting model to look at as a benchmark. I understand there's around 147 overdose prevention sites globally in 91 communities in 16 countries. Do the rest of the panel have any thoughts on other potential benchmarks that the committee might want to look at in terms of where it's performing relatively well, based on your experience, if anyone has any immediate thoughts on that?
I've visited a few in different countries and they all operate similarly but also differently, and probably Barcelona is probably where I've had some of my thoughts in terms of the different types of models. There were some of those that were based within hospital settings, there were mobile units, there were fixed site units, there were some that were led by peers, there were some that really involved a sort of community approach, there was one that was opposite a police station. So there were lots of different types of models, and I think, you know, once these start to be introduced, you would hope that then they would be accepted as for what they are. And certainly, you know, in all the evidence from all the countries that introduced them. Well, part of what I did previously when I went to explore and bring back some evidence for Scotland about these facilities was to try and give a balanced picture and say, like, here's some of the positives that we have for introducing them here, and here's some of the potential negatives. And you literally can't argue against them because they're just overwhelmingly positive in terms of the outcomes that it can produce. So I think there's lots of learning from all countries. countries, and obviously Switzerland was the first to do them and now have multiple facilities as well.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very much. I know some members are interested in asking some questions around stigma, so I'm going to bring in Claire Hawkey and then Gillian Mackay.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for coming along this morning. There was a very helpful piece of evidence from the Scottish Recovery Consortium submitted to committee, and it highlighted how the biggest challenge to accessing treatment or accessing recovery communities was stigma. And a note from the final report of the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force that they also highlighted stigma and said there had to be a broad cultural change from stigma, discrimination and punishment with regards to offering treatment and care for people with addiction issues. So I'd be keen to hear from the panel, how effective do you think action has been in terms of tackling stigma to date? We'll start with Simon and then come to Wes.
I think some of the groundwork has been started in terms of reducing stigma. I still feel that probably alcohol and drug related harm is still very much rooted in specialist services, EDPs, specialist groups within the country. I think there does need to be a wider debate and, I suppose, engagement with the public, particularly if we're getting into the territory of drug consumption, overdose prevention, decriminalisation. I think we need to have a better understanding around the drivers for people to understand some of the root causes for the problems that people experience and what they can do to help. I think we've already seen in the press some of the comments or social media, some of the comments around, you know, the idea of drug consumption rooms or overdose prevention centres, etc., and people sort of misinterpreting or misunderstanding some of that. So in a sense, I go back to that point, these things can't fail, we can't allow them to fail, and we need to engage with the public in relation to that. I think the second bit is then the wider system. So I suppose to some extent it's much more in our direct control, but certainly welcome the leadership from having a cross government committee looking at these things. So I think it does need that sort of leadership across health and social care services, all public services really, in terms of taking a lens to the whole issue of drug and alcohol harm and making sure that every opportunity counts and that our systems that are there to help people aren't barriers to people accessing help. Ideally, we wouldn't need a lot of these investments in terms of overdose prevention centres or other facilities like that if people were able to get mainstream help for some of the issues. So that will take a long time to sort of get to that point where the health issues related, the health and social issues related to substance use are adequately supported in mainstream services, and that people can access all that without feeling stigmatised or judged. But I think that will take a while.
Wes, did you want to come in here?
Yes, please. Thank you. I think we've really got a long, long way to go in reducing stigma, even in specialist services. I think we still see a lot of paternal and punitive practice, even around people, around appointment systems, people being discharged, people being reduced on their prescriptions for other substance use. I think, if we're not getting it right in specialist services, I think we've definitely then got a long way to go in the wider support services that we've potentially got out there. I'll just speak very quickly, if I may, just to my own personal experience. The irony for me as a problematic substance user was that I had an inability to even try and address my substance use until I was accepted along with it. And what I see often, I believe, in services is we're trying to lead people towards outcomes that they haven't necessarily voiced they want to pursue. And again, the irony for me is when I was kind of accepted, warts and all, for want of a better phrase, was when I could start looking at some of the support needs I had. And I do feel we've got a long, long way to go in services in Scotland.
Thanks. I think you touched on a few issues here that I'd like to explore a wee bit further, if that's okay. You spoke about leadership, and about leading people to outcomes that they don't necessarily want. And you also touched on some of the commentary that there's been in the press. Can I just quote to you a couple of things that I've seen recently from MSPs in this parliament? So one wrote, some campaigners have long demanded drug consumption rooms where addicts will be free to take heroin, crack cocaine and other dangerous narcotics. Another tweeted, I have serious concerns for locals. This is in relation to the sighting of the Glasgow consumption room. It's very close to a large amount of student housing as well as a fire station and family shopping areas. How does that help to tackle stigma and get people to access the help and care and treatment that they need? Simon.
I don't think it does. I think it just reinforces a lot of the stereotypes. I mean, I suppose some of the behaviour and some of the public's perception of people who use substances has been driven by the fact that we criminalise the use of substances. You know, we say drugs are bad and therefore people who use the drugs are bad. And it's a devastating situation for any individual or family to be in. And we need, obviously, mixed ways of dealing with it. But in Scotland, we have got a significant issue and a significant problem, and we need to recognise that there are 60,000 people in Scotland who are not coping with life very well and need lots of non-judgmental help and support to reduce some of the harm. But we need to be able to engage with the public on that and not just be seen as working against the public's concerns or fears that might be there.
Tracy?
Yeah, we all have a responsibility to really look at ourselves in relation to our communications, our words, our actions and our language. So all of us as leaders in Scotland, and when we talk about tackling stigma, the first place for me is me. Mm-hmm. I need to think about my language, my attitude, my values, and create an environment in my workplace with my staff teams that we can challenge that stigma. So I think the first place to start is ourselves, and I think that's really important. Individually, institutionally, in society, there's problems with stigma across a range of different things. Mental health, justice, addictions, homelessness. Again, if this is a joint committee, there's an opportunity here to really take a national look at this. And I mean going back to education and training. I mean in primary school. And this is about vulnerability. So take away the drug and alcohol stigma per se. This is about people being different. Mm-hmm. And this is about people being judged around their differences and vulnerabilities. That cuts across a range of policy areas. So I think there is a massive opportunity. There's a huge way to go, as my colleagues have said. But I do think this is bigger than just addictions. This is about training, education, primary school, secondary school, workplace, academia. Goes right through the whole system. And we have to accept that this will take a long time. It shouldn't stop us, but we need to keep drip feeding this approach right across a range of different policy areas. So another opportunity to join the dots.
Mm-hmm. So from the final report, the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force, one of the things that they said is this is everyone's responsibility. And it sounds like from what you're saying, Tracy, you wholeheartedly agree with that statement.
10%. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Bring in Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, convener. Just to pick up on what you were just saying there, Tracy, about the multiple ways people can be stigmatised, how do we address that compound stigma for people who use drugs? The stigma also related to mental health conditions, bloodborne viruses, housing status, various other things that may also be impacting those individuals. That stigma we know kills, and we know it is compounded across these other things as well. But how do we give a voice to the impact of that stigma? Because that's one thing I don't think we hear enough of. We all know it has an impact on individuals, but I don't think we hear that in people's own words enough in this space. And do you think enough is being done to address that compound stigma?
that was one of the reasons why Scottish Recovery Consortium really wanted to get the voices of lived experience across, because you go into most treatment services and most recovery communities across Scotland and they'll tell you examples of how they've been stigmatised. So again, this is another opportunity to really raise the voice and amplify the voice of lived experience. Stigma absolutely devastates communities, whole communities potentially. It also devastates families, also devastates children within those families. Is there one solution? No. If you were asking me for a solution in relation to drugs and alcohol just in isolation, then there's a huge challenge ahead in relation to workforce development. Mm-hmm. How are we training people in relation to working with drug and alcohol? What's our learning experience? This goes back to a bigger question for me, actually, because we need to think about how we're commissioning services differently, because we think about, we say words like trauma-informed, person-centred, human rights-based approach. What does that mean? Mm-hmm. That means we need to do things differently. In order to do things differently, we need to commission services differently so that staff don't... I mean, you could put 1,000 staff in Scotland in a training course about reducing stigma. It needs to be embedded in their workplace. So that means supervision, support, coaching and mentoring. There's very little room now to do that because the way services are commissioned, because we're so stretched. So again, this is really big discussions that we have to have, but I think we should be having them. So I don't have an answer, but I'm happy to continue those chats. But it's multi-pronged, but there's a massive workforce development issue in that for me too.
That's great, thanks. I think Simon wants to come in.
I just would echo what Tracy has said in terms of workforce and that investment in that infrastructure. I think there are voices there. And there are people giving consistent messages. I just wonder who's listening and if it's the right people that are listening. And if the right people are not listening, then we're not going to see the changes that are required, would be my view.
Thank you. I think increasing the skill mix in the teams and increasing the mix of people with lived and living experience of substance use in specialist service, in third sector service providers. I think as well services could do some mystery shopper type research into their own services to actually find out what it is like coming and presenting at a service, rather than it being from a kind of top-down approach, actually what does it feel like for someone walking through that door asking for help and support, and to really see what the environment is like for people.
That's a really interesting suggestion and something I definitely think we should take back. Just moving on to a slightly different topic, we've often spoken in Parliament about the need for a no wrong door approach. Is there evidence this is being implemented in practice, or are people who use drugs still facing barriers for when accessing, for example, mental health treatment and other services? That would particularly come back to what we were saying earlier on about thresholds and things as well to services. I don't know, Tracy.
Yeah, we have a strange thing in Scotland whereby mental health services comes in through a funding stream, addictions comes in through a funding stream, justice comes in through a funding stream, housing and homelessness comes in through a range of different funding streams. That creates silos. Mm. So it is sometimes really difficult to have that no wrong door approach throughout that whole system. And are we there yet? No, because it's indicated in the Drug Desk Task Force and in the cross government action plan. Does it happen in some areas? Yes. Is there pockets of good practice? Yes. But I think what doesn't help that is the way the funding stream comes in from government to local authority, because it creates silos. And I think that's potentially some learning, and actually we could probably save for money in relation to if we actually funded things slightly differently. So are we there yet? No. Is some areas working? Yes. But I think there's a long way to go in terms of that no wrong approach.
And very, very briefly, if there was one area of anti-stigma work the panel would like to see prioritised, what would it be?
Thanks, Wes. I think if we were to truly address stigma, we would also decriminalise people who use drugs, and I think that would go a long way to moving the discussion away from punishment to support. So I think that would play a big role. If I may just come back on your comments around the sort of no wrong door thing in terms of the mental health, my background's mental health nursing, and for over 10 years seen the difficulties with people accessing mental health specialist support. However, what I do firmly believe is that we do have a high proportion of mental health nurses working within our drug treatment services. Mm-hmm. And the majority of people who attend drug treatment services have got some level of mental health going on for them, mental health issues going on for them. So I do think it's a capacity issue as well in services to be able to provide adequate mental health support rather than always trying to push off to other different services. And with the no wrong door approach, I would also like to see different ways of us providing treatment. So also providing prescribing through the third sector. I can't remember who was talking about prescribers earlier, but having prescribers based within third sector services as well, and providing people with that choice around which service they access to get their prescribing, I think would be important. Thank you.
Wes, were you looking to come in?
I think short of decriminalisation, I think staff training, I think it would be really useful for services to have a really robust reflexive practice session type policy in place for people to explore their own kind of belief systems, I guess. I think for me personally, I've been on quite a lengthy journey around, you know, even fighting my own writing reflex. It's really difficult sometimes to try and support people when you see they're doing massive harm to themselves and others around them, but have that real impartial, non-judgmental, professional approach to them still. So I think it is a really big ask to kind of ask people. So I think, workforce development training type package, I would say.
That's great. Thank you. Simon, were you looking to come in?
I think an immediate thing that we could all do, I think one of the most harmful things just now is blame. That, you know, we blame services for not doing the right thing or not being perfect, or we blame people for using substances. I think taking the blame out of it would help a lot in terms of just even reinforcing the positive message to the workforce at the front line, that, you know, by and large, I know individual people will have their own experiences, but we are all working flat out to try and improve things and make things better. And, you know, 90% or 100% of the workforce, I think, are there to try and do the right thing. There will be obviously be people, you know, different people there for different reasons, but the vast majority of people are trying to do the right thing. It just makes it much more difficult and complicated if there is stigma and blame compounding the situation for people trying to do the right thing.
Two things, sorry. Very quickly, for all of us as leaders, just to reflect on ourselves, and I think, because I can change me, and I can do that today, so there's something around all of us doing that. But it would be really good to see more lived experience within the treatment system, because that helps all of us see that it's possible and change is possible and people have something to contribute. So that's absolutely two things, sorry, but yeah.
No, two good things. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Okay, thanks, Gillian. I'm going to bring in Russell Finlay. I apologise. I should have brought you in earlier.
You,
I know you were
interested
in asking some questions around safe consumption
rooms.
Yeah,
I was just going to come back.
I'm happy to bring you.
Thank you. I was just going to come back to drug consumption rooms. And I know, Kirsten, you've spoken passionately about previous committee meetings. You've worked on it for 7 years, and your knowledge is, I think, probably unmatched. It's more about the practicalities, and I should perhaps know this, and maybe it's been said, but is the facility in Glasgow going to be run by the NHS entirely? Yeah, okay.
I don't know the exact detail of this, but when the original discussions had been happening, the sort of aftercare area was going to be a partnership approach. So I can't confirm whether that's happening and that they were going to have lived experience roles and remits within there. So I don't know for sure if that's the case.
And my understanding, primarily, this is about safe injecting, but it's not necessarily limited to that. Do we know that yet? Would it be other substances as well?
I don't think they're proceeding with the inhalation element of it just because of the restrictions in terms of what they're able to provide at the moment. So it would just be for substances to be injected.
So that's been decided as far as we know?
I think so, yeah.
All right, OK. Right. Again, though, Simon talked about flexibility, about perhaps other facilities opening elsewhere in the country where there's different needs. So, for example, in an area where Glasgow's got a big problem with crack cocaine, if that's required, is that the next step, or should this facility offer that as well?
I would really hope that would come out in evaluation. You know, as soon as that starts being looked at, what are people presenting with? What sort of substances are people appearing with? And I think that would be, Tracy mentioned earlier about sort of timely action based on evaluation as well, and I think that would be one of the key things as well. So I think this evaluation will highlight a lot of things that could be done differently and that should be introduced.
But from the starting point, it's injection only as far as we know.
Yes.
You believe it should, from the beginning, include inhalation of certain substances?
I think if we were providing a full range of support, yeah, we should be providing inhalation, but I don't think that's Glasgow's fault for not doing that. I think they're restricted in terms of what they're allowed to do.
Right, OK. Now, there's been talk about stigma as well. This particular facility is near a couple of businesses who've been identified in the media, and they may have difficulties with having this on the doorstep, with given the associations with the crime that might take place and the behaviours that might occur. The Scottish Social Attitude Survey shows significant numbers of people in this country might support rehabilitation and treatment, but they don't want it on their doorstep. So how do we persuade people that this is something that should be in their community or on their doorstep? And anyone can come in on that. I don't know if there's...
I just go back to the point, it needs to be properly staffed, and we need to win the hearts and minds of the public in terms of there not being incidents and spill out sort of behaviours and things like that. So, I mean, that's all I could really suggest, is that, you know, having the right number of staff, making sure that it's a safe environment for the public and the people using it.
So show them it works. Is that, Tracy, do you have anything to add to that?
We can't do to communities. We need to take communities with us. And there's been a number of examples over the years whether it's been a residential rehabilitation service that's been set up and there was local opposition, but actually in some of those rehabilitation services now the community actually engage. So it's about demystifying some of the stigma that's attached to this work. So we need proper consultation. I think Kirsten said that was going to be happening. We need to talk to the community. We need to acknowledge their fears and say, we get it. However, there's an evidence base to say that there's no one, an evidence base across the world to say there's not going to be that crime across in that area. There won't be an increase in drug use in that area. So I think we really need to start demystifying this. I think, again, all of us have a responsibility as leaders is to say, right, OK, this is what it means to take people with us. And actually, my experience in developing services over the years, if you take the community with you, they get it. But don't just drop it in to say this is happening in your area. And I don't think Glasgow are planning that. I think Glasgow are planning a huge range of consultations. That will include local businesses as well. It needs to. Because there's fear in this, and that needs to be acknowledged.
OK, thank you. Can I quickly move on to legislation?
Of
yeah,
course.
Thank you very much. Now, there's a lot of talk about decriminalisation being necessary or desirable. But in reality, if you take the most recent statistics, there was just over 30,000 people found in possession of drugs in Scotland in 2019-2020. And of that, just over 30,000, 158 were convicted of possession. Is it not the case that effectively already the police and the Crown are operating a de facto decriminalisation? And I don't know who would want to come in on that. Kirsten?
Yeah. Thank you. I think it's that... It's more about how a person is perceived in terms of decriminalisation and taking away that sort of punitive undertone for all of that is key. I would really like to know, we introduced a policy of, I guess it was described at the time as de facto decriminalisation when we made possession of all classes of substances eligible for recorded police warnings. We don't seem to have any data on that at all about how that's been rolled out in practice. I'd be really interested to find out how that's actually operating, whether that's actually being beneficial for people who would want it to be beneficial for, in terms of our target group, people experiencing drug problems. So that, I think that's one area of it, but I do think that sending less people to prison, putting people less people through the court system, but just having a general sense that what people were doing wasn't illicit is quite a lot for a person as well.
But people aren't getting sent to prison for possession of drugs.
But they're going through the court system and through, you know, they might be getting fines and all of that sort of undertone,
but
in terms of the criminality is still there.
Possession, the numbers are minuscule.
And it also makes people a hidden population, though, as well. The reason why people are injecting in unsafe environments is because they're hiding away their drug use from the population. They're, you know, just the whole culture that it affects for people would be massively switched on its head without that criminalisation.
We've struggled to get data on use of recorded police warnings. There was the Lord Advocate's announcement in 2021. Is that the one you're referring to?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what she said at that time is there would be a presumption against prosecution, which, based on the figures I've just referenced, effectively already exists. But she did say that she, or the Crown, ought to reserve the right to prosecute where it's deemed appropriate to do so. Do you agree with that, or is that completely wrong? Should there just be a blanket non-prosecution?
Yeah.
Is that the universal view?
For personal use of substances, sorry.
Yeah, I think when it's left to anyone's discretion, I think stigma then can still play a part. I think, you know, you get an inconsistency across different localities and different geographical areas. And I think that full decriminalisation would have a massive shift in the public's perception. I think the public might not, you know, some people that might not have any experience of substance use themselves or a loved one with substance use will presume that it must be bad if it is therefore illegal. And I think that's not necessarily accurate. So I think it could do more than just influence and have a more positive outcome on the person using the substances themselves. I think it could have a societal impact.
I think was Simon wanting to come in?
It's okay.
No. And just very quickly, just on that very point, I think the Lord Advocate wanted to maintain that right for the purpose of prosecuting those who are dealing, but they've got possession amounts on them, and that might be the reflection on these figures. But that aside, you still think it's the wrong thing, that there should be the right to prosecute. And I don't maybe repeating yourself, but
I guess it's probably quite difficult for me to comment properly, because I would want to know what the exact thresholds are and the amounts. So someone who's got really problematic substance use is probably going to be carrying what police might term dealing amounts for their daily consumption. Someone who's using less frequently is going to be carrying much less. So again, I think it's all open to interpretation and open to the discretions of the officers, whereas if there was just really strong guidance kind of one way or the other, I think you get a more consistent approach.
And if we had better data and a better understanding of how recorded police warnings worked, we could assess this a lot better. But yeah.
Yeah, we facilitate groups of people with living experience of substance use across the country. We're probably meeting with about 200 individuals every week across Scotland. And the subject of this comes up, and it's different from, you know, how you might receive a police warning or be subject to that in the borders to Glasgow, for instance. So we're finding real discrepancies in what people are reporting about their own experiences.
I just can't understand the resistance to providing full details as to what criteria are used for recorded police warnings. But there we go. Sorry.
I can't answer that specific point you just ended on. But I do think there is a sort of a discussion that needs to happen around decriminalisation and legalisation and just unpacking exactly what we mean by these terms. I think one of the most powerful speakers I've heard around that whole subject is Crispin Blunt, who is very much in favour of regulation of the supply side. So we've got this situation where we're decriminalising the demand side of the you know, let's think of it as a business in a sense, decriminalising that demand side, but we're not tackling necessarily or changing the supply side. So there is that's where the majority of the harm comes. So I think that decriminalisation has to come with some rethinking about how we're tackling the supply side. And I think that probably you know, according to Crisp and Blunt, and that the really interesting thing that things that he's talked about, it's about regulation. So it's not just decriminalisation, it's decriminalisation in the context of regulation as well. So rethinking about how we classify drugs, the harm that they cause. It's not just decriminalising that anybody can go and use a substance whenever they want and drive a car or teach a school or anything like that. There needs to be some parameters around all of it. And that is really the important bit, I think, about trying to engage people in that discussion, the whole population in that discussion.
OK, thank you. I've got time to come back in. Out of time.
Bring you back in time. OK, I'm going to bring in Katie Clark just on the issue of law reform, and then I'm going to move to some questions around MAT standards. I'm just watching the time. Are panel happy to stay on just a little bit beyond 10:30, because I'm loath to cut things off when there's some very helpful discussion going on. So, Katie, over to you, and then I'll bring in Sue Webber.
Thank you, and I'm here from the Criminal Justice Committee, and I think you've made the case and been very clear about some of the public health arguments for decriminalisation and indeed other harm reduction measures. But I'm quite interested in the points that Simon is making in relation to supply side. So could you maybe respond as to what you think the impact of some of these kind of proposals, such as decriminalisation, would be on reducing problem drug use, but also on the organised drug trade? I don't know if Simon would want to come in on that.
Well, I guess the concern is that decriminalisation doesn't necessarily impact on the supply side. The supply side is hugely harmful to the population and the most vulnerable people impacted on that. And in effect, it's a pyramid scheme in terms of how people are exploited and our most vulnerable communities are exploited in relation to the supply side. I think what decriminalisation does is allow us to... I go around in circles about whether decriminalisation is the right thing or a harmful thing. I think it's absolutely right not to criminalise people for the trauma that they've experienced, the difficult lives, the poverty, etc. And that criminalising those parts of the population doesn't help. And in fact, I think all the evidence would suggest it makes things worse. But I guess what decriminalisation does do is it shifts our thinking about how do we educate people around substances? How do we invest? We know what the drivers are, but is there the long-term investment in terms of parenting and attachment and reducing trauma, etc., that would help the longer-term aspects of harmful substance use? I guess the other sort of jargon that gets around is sort of people using it on a recreational basis, and that's, again, a sort of different population potentially using different substances for enjoyment. And, you know, people do enjoy elements of substance use. We all do in terms of alcohol and tea and coffee. You know, these are all substances. But so I think we need to reform our relationship with substances a little bit and think about what actually are we trying to achieve and how do we reduce the most amount of harm to our vulnerable populations. And I go back to points that Tracy's made in terms of, you know, for the size of Scotland, you know, absolutely we can have joined up health and social care in terms of mental health, justice, etc. You know, so much time and energy is created by the harm that it makes it difficult to join up and get the integrated holistic care that people need. So I do think there are opportunities within that whole discussion about decriminalisation, challenging stigma, to really have a more structural change to how we respond to the harm, the evident harm that is across Scotland at the moment.
Would any of the other witnesses like to come in on those specific points about the impact of policies such as decriminalisation on perhaps the numbers of problem drug users there would be in Scotland, whether it would likely increase or decrease or maybe have no impact, and indeed its implications with organised crime, effectively, through the drugs trade?
I think by reducing the stigma, it encourages people to access treatment, and I think that would definitely assist more people into treatment, for sure. I just wanted to comment, last week I was at the University of Strathclyde for an event that they were holding around, and there were presentations from international speakers about drug trafficking and it's just relentless. So when we're talking about, you know, regulation and whatnot, I mean, decriminalisation, yes, would absolutely be a positive step forward. But globally, if we don't address the global drug trade in terms of trafficking and, you know, look towards regulation in the future, one of the international speakers described it as a rat race. I mean, it's just relentless in terms of trying to chase drugs constantly, the amount of resource that goes into that. I do sincerely hope that in decades to come, people will look back on this period and be like, what were they thinking? Like, continuing with this illicit prohibition approach. I'm not sure that for Scotland, I'm going off on a bit of a tangent, because I'm not sure that for Scotland, we could just regulate and everything would be fine. I think it needs a global approach, but there's only so much. Yes, decriminalisation, positive, but there's only so far you can go against a prohibition context.
Do folks want to come in on that at all? No?
Okay. I think it's really important to look at the evidence base around this, and if we are moving towards decriminalisation, then there is something around. If we choose to decriminalise and take a public health approach, then people need access to services to support their addiction in the first place. So areas across the world have done it, but they have had massive investment around that public health, social context, treatment and support. If we're taking people out of the justice system, not decriminalising them and giving them the options of treatment need to be there. So there's a huge investment in relation to that too.
Sort of point of clarification to Kirsten. I mean, you know, a lot of the drugs come from places like Afghanistan and Colombia. So what do you mean by regulation?
I mean, like, legalisation in terms of our drug market in the future. I do think, you know, that sensibly that would be an appropriate way forward in the future. I mean, we at the moment, you know, substances change all the time. You know, we get fixated on which benzos are the most current in Scotland, but the market just changes constantly. But there are changes in Afghanistan in terms of what's happening over there that may well interrupt the heroin market for Scotland, and then we would start to see more toxic substances introduced, like nitazenes that have been talked about, synthetic opioids. Unfortunately, we will know as soon as we get an influx of those here, because people will be overdosing even more than they are currently because of the nature of those types of drugs. So I just think, as a nation, as a global economy, the legalisation would, I think, be a good move forward in the future. I'm not saying that's something we should be introducing through this Parliament, but I'm thinking that it's something in the future that we should be looking at and keeping an eye on.
OK, fine. I think, Simon, you'd like to come in, and then I think, Gillian, you'd also like to come in. So, Simon first.
Yeah, I do think the bigger threat is the synthetic substances that are coming. I mean, the traditional sort of Afghanistan, South American sort of routes are there and will continue, presumably. But I do think the synthetic manufacture of substances is extremely harmful in lots of different ways. And I think, you know, we use lots of different words, decriminalisation, legalisation, etc. I think for me the important bit is regulation, not necessarily, you know, there's a spectrum, I think, and I think it's for Scotland to work out what is the best way to try and regulate and ensure that if people are going to use substances, that that's in a controlled, safe supply sort of environment that involves services and the wraparound care. I guess there's still that fundamental point, you know, if we go down these routes, will the numbers of people using substances increase? I think if there's, I suppose it's about why are people vulnerable to using substances to manage and cope with their lives in a way, and how do we get into that space rather than just focusing on the substances themselves? How do we actually help people, and what do people need to be resilient or cope with the challenges that we all face?
Yeah. Just to come back on Kirsten's comments just there, if we know what's in these drugs, if we do that level of regulation and things, what do you believe the public health outcomes for that is? We know one of the issues is that people aren't aware of what is the strength of the drugs that they're taking. Often what is in them. They're told it's one thing, it's not, it's got something else in it as well. What do you believe the public health outcomes of that policy approach would be?
Address a lot of that through drug checking services right now. If we were able to provide services where people could actually check what was in the substances that they were using, people would have more autonomy over their substance use and be able to make informed decisions about what they were actually using. I mean, it's just so difficult for people to even know at the minute. So there are other countries that have made real efforts in terms of drug checking, and we don't have pilots yet. I know there are pilots in progress potentially for Scotland, but those would be hugely beneficial for people, just to give that autonomy and allow people to make safer choices.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay, thanks very much. So we'll move on to some questions around MAT standards. I'll bring in Sue and then Paul.
Thank you, Convener. We've heard a lot today about accessing services, and I think one of the first comments was that access to treatment is one of the key drivers of the drug-related deaths. I think that might have been yourself, Wes, that said that. Do you... And I've got them in front. They all start with all people, all people, all people. But clearly not all people are getting access to these MAT standards that require them or wish them. What more could be done to assist in that? Simon. Where did I get Stuart from? Simon.
I go back to workforce investment. Mm-hmm. I think there needs to be an infrastructure that supports these sorts of quality developments. Our services in Aberdeen, I'm not sure necessarily whether we'll achieve all the standards. We've made good progress. I believe we have good services and very committed staff, but the structural challenges that we have are fundamental. I think the standards are a good thing. I do worry that they perhaps become a bit over complicated.
What do you mean by that?
Well, just I think all the things that we're trying to do in terms of gather experience, people's experiences and feedback, the data and improving the quality and having processes, etc. These are all the right things to do, but I don't feel that we've got the infrastructure to necessarily support it.
Okay.
And I think that certainly in terms of the finance and the way that the finance is communicated by the Drug Policy Unit is complicated. I think that we will have quite soon large numbers of staff that have started innovative projects in terms of bits of funding that have come through CORA or other funding streams. I think at one point we've counted that we've got 17 income streams as an ADP that we're trying to manage and make sure that services are joined up. We will quite shortly have staff who are on project, working on projects, looking for security in terms of whether those projects are going to continue, etc. So I do worry that the momentum is huge and it needs to be continued and potentially scaled up. So I think the MAT standards are a huge task, and I understand that the political pressure from people is to get them delivered as quickly as possible, and everybody would want to do that, but it is a big piece of work, and I think that we don't necessarily have the infrastructure to support that.
Suzanne Gallagher from Scottish Families Affected by Alcohol and Drugs has sort of made some comments related that far too much time and effort being spent on MAT standards 1 to 5, and we're not really progressing onto the others. And I know, Kirsten, you spoke at the very beginning about it's an emergency. We talk about that, but we don't get a sense of that on the ground. So can perhaps Simon first on that?
I mean, I think having it badged as a public health emergency, I think, is useful because it galvanises people and it sets it in the context of being an emergency. But we can't sustain an emergency response for years and years. We need to build the infrastructure that sort of makes some of these things business as usual.
Okay.
So from my point of view, that's what we need. I think, yes, there's been a lot of front-loading for MAT standards 1 to 5. I think certainly in terms of psychology support, the infrastructure, I mean, the bit about funding coming in different silos is one thing, but actually mental health services are as equally stretched and challenged around the tasks that they have. That at the moment, certainly in the North East, it feels a bit like people haven't got the headspace to be innovative or be creative. The funding, if we don't spend it, doesn't get retained. Mm-hmm. The government pulled that back, or you know, I'm not quite sure. I don't quite understand always what the restrictions around the funding are, and it's very directed. Mm. So, you know, one of the things we've tried to have a discussion with the policy unit is to have an investment plan for Aberdeen and our aspirations, and have something that's a bit more relationship based in terms of investment and aspiration, rather than it being, you know, a letter and, you know, nothing happening in between. So I think there's more that the policy unit could be doing to support the sort of implementation.
It's back to the agility that Kirsten spoke about earlier on when you're talking about things as well. Kirsten, do you want to come in on
it? I'm just reflecting on, we're doing a piece of peer research at the moment where we're following about 60 people on their journey of trying to access treatment. We're doing this in a number of health board areas, and just reflecting on some of the real challenges that they're seeing. One of those has been that we'd intended with this, it was like an observational study that we're doing, following people around to their appointments and whatnot. And one of the challenges has been that people aren't being offered face-to-face appointments, and that it's all been over the phone. So that's been like something that we were quite shocked about in terms of that follow-up. So I think those will be really interesting to the committee and to partners when we look at the findings of that, just to see what the reality is for some people. And don't get me wrong, there are some good examples as well. A lot of the good examples come from people talking about just being treated well by staff. You know, it sometimes doesn't take a load of qualifications, it's just about being a nice human to people. So people aren't asking for a lot. I do think in terms of what might improve access is something mentioned earlier about having our third sector more involved in being able to deliver prescribing. Sorry, I'll let Tracy speak on that. But that is something that we would really support, different places for people to go for their services.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks. Tracy, then.
Again, institutional memories are really... It can be positive and a negative, but I'm old enough to know that we had the same discussions when OST and methadone was getting implemented across Scotland, whereby it became a very clinical approach to get people into treatment, and then we realised you need the wraparound support to go with that, or else you won't make any difference. And it's the same kind of conversations right now. Treatment is really important. People need to get into treatment. That reduces the risk, that reduces the harm. But there needs to be more than just treatment around these. And I'm not really seeing that yet in the MAT standards in relation to that psychological support and the underpinning approach around the MAT standards about social networks, recovery communities and moving people out of treatment. And I think, Simon, you're absolutely spot on. We need to move away from crisis management to embedding that into business as usual. And that's really, really important. Underpinning all of this goes back to a no wrong door. Mm-hmm. Where people come, we should be asking them, what do you need support with? And that sounds complex, it sounds really easy, and it can be quite complex, but we need to be looking across the different systems, justice, homelessness, mental health and addictions. And as Kirsten's point in terms of face-to-face, we see that across the country. So it is amazing to get people into treatment, but that needs to be followed up by regular relationships. Mm-hmm. So having a prescription and going to the chemist every day and not seeing your key worker for weeks on end does not build the foundations of a relationship where somebody can change. Okay. And I think some of this is really basic stuff that we've moved away from that we need to get back to.
That's been very helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks. And Paul Sweeney.
No, thanks for that insight. And I think it really helps to inform us on this. And it was interesting just to reflect on the interface of the previous theme we discussed around supply chains, you know, noting the habit of the National Health Service to prescribe routinely benzodiazepines through the 1990s up until there was a kind of sudden pivot point around the early 2000s when prescribing has since been restricted, thus seeding a illicit supply chain, which has caused significant problems, as you're well aware, driven the drug-related deaths. So in that respect, looking at the MAT standards, we know that the June figures demonstrate that a third of alcohol and drug partnerships have failed to implement the first five standards, and we've kind of covered some of the broad reasons for that. But looking at the overdose prevention pilot in Glasgow, do you think that that presents a potentially novel interface for looking at how we can improve MAT standards and actually provide that kind of integrated interface for people to access care, where it's about street bought drugs, but then actually transitioning into a MAT, a more controlled MAT environment, rather than relying on dangerous drugs supplied by organised criminals?
Yeah, I don't mind coming in on that. I don't think it's its primary goal, but absolutely that would be something that would be an addition of the service, absolutely. And like I said, the more times people attend a service like that, the more likely they are to then go on and access treatment. And going back to your previous point as well, like the benefit, I guess, of that co-location is inevitably people that are working in the facility will be having those discussions with people around treatment options, and the heroin-assisted treatment service will most likely have more recruits into the programme from that. I do think it offers up a unique opportunity to engage with people that don't often engage with services, hence why we would like to see them in different areas across Scotland, particularly where there are already issues with people injecting in outdoor type environments. And that reaching out and that offering a connection is one of the sort of biggest goals of a service, to be able to get people thinking about what options they might want for their future. So I think it will be useful and we could see more of them.
Thanks.
I think for me, stepping back from the drug consumption bit, I mean, I suppose the objective is to try and give people a safe, clean environment for people to engage in harm reduction activity, whether that's injecting or all the other sort of harm reduction work that we can do. I think for me, it still comes down to the structural challenge. Absolutely, we would want to have a whole range of absolutely low threshold ways that people can access all the support and need support that they need. But it still comes down to the structural capacity to be able to do that. And, you know, have we got staff? Can we make it safe for staff? Can we make it safe for the public? Can we make it safe for people who need to use that? And how is it best delivered for that local community? And involving people to be involved in involving people in that consultation and that sort of groundwork that needs to happen. So for me, that underpinning structural capability to engage and do that properly is fundamental. The actual, you know, the pilot in Glasgow is designed to meet a specific need in Glasgow in terms of people who are injecting in streets and in unclean environments. Which is not necessarily replicated across Scotland, that we do need to be able to use legislation creatively to find solutions that people need and want in their local area.
It's not an either or for me, really. And I think if you look at the Glasgow example, that's primarily because there is a cohort of really vulnerable people at real risk of drug-related death and associated harm. But for me, there's a bigger, wider system in relation to the MAT standards that people should get access to treatment when they need it, for as long as they need it, with the wraparound support. So it's not an either-or for me. But I do think that the example in Glasgow is for a specific population, for a specific need. As Simon said, that will be different all over the country in relation to what people need. But the fundamental is people should get access to treatment when they need it, for as long as they need it. And they should be treated with dignity and respect, and it should be holistic, and that should be wrap around. Excuse the jargon, but yeah.
Can I just ask on that? Sorry, we wanted to come in on that point.
If I may, I think there's something quite powerful about just meeting that population's need and about changing the attitudes and the cultures. You know, if there is a cohort of vulnerable people that need a service in which to come and use their drugs, and I think that can have wider implications for other kind of support needs that are out there, if that makes sense. Yeah. Just changing that kind of perception, and that services can respond and meet needs where they're seen.
Yeah. Just wanted to ask as a follow-up to that, do you feel there is still a big institutional culture change needed in Scotland generally? I know, for example, when the unofficial overdose prevention pilot ran in Glasgow, the Dean of the Medical School at Glasgow University wrote to the students who were volunteering on it saying, "You're jeopardising your GMC registration as doctors, desist from doing this." For example, that people were threatened with losing their jobs in third sector providers for volunteering and participating in these kind of activities. Do you still feel there is an instinctive risk aversion from a lot of third sector and public sector bodies about engaging in MAT provision?
I wonder if some of that, commenting on something I don't actually know anything about, but I wonder if some of that is to do with if people were prosecuted, or I suppose we all have liability, public liability, professional liability in terms of insurance and cover. So it's some of those things that need to be addressed. I think that's different to the point you're maybe trying to make, which is, you know, are there institutions fundamentally against what we're trying to do? I mean, certainly in Aberdeen, I think, you know, we would welcome the opportunity to discuss and plan for services that meet the needs of people, whatever shape or form that is. But it does need that structural capability of, you know, insurance and reassurance from the institutions, whether the third sector or otherwise, in terms of making it safe for people.
Any other points that people want to make?
I think it comes down to stigma. I think it comes down to no understanding the problem, and as a society in Scotland, who are we if we do not try and support the most vulnerable? So there's a real fundamental question in that for me, but I think fundamentally it comes down to stigma. I don't think you'll get many third sector organisations that don't understand the rationale that's behind the MAT standards. I think there's still challenges across the NHS, and I think we need to be clear about that. I think there's challenges across statutory services, but again, I think it's down to stigma, Paul.
Okay, yeah. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Okay, thanks very much. I think, Ros McCall, you wanted to come in with.
I did, and first and foremost, spot the new girl in the room, so my apologies for sitting quietly. And I also want to say thank you to all of you, because I've intently been listening for the last hour and a half or so, which has been very informative. Tracy, you alluded to a point there, which to me, in my lack of knowledge, sounded very much about the national specification that had been mentioned before about treatment and recovery system that should be there across Scotland. I know we've moved on a little bit, but I want to come back on that, because I'd be interested in your opinion as witnesses as how we should prioritise the creation of a national specification. Where do you think we are on it, and you know, what are your thoughts on that? I know we're taking it on to a slightly different angle, but it certainly was alluded to in the last piece of information. So I would be interested, Tracy, if you wouldn't mind starting.
Yeah.
And then if anybody else wants to come in on that.
Thank you. And what we know is variable across Scotland. So there has been a lot of work done around the national specification and framework around residential rehab, and I believe that's moving on apace. So that provides that national framework, national outcomes, national reporting, understanding what that looks like, but hopefully bring in that local flexibility and that local need. But again, I think data is a really important part in this puzzle, because ultimately, if we're not using the data to flex and shift and redesign and reevaluate our provision to shift around the population needs, then there's a fundamental flaw in that. So national specification is good. It provides those things. There needs to be local flexibility. What's missing, and potentially going back to the MAT standards for ME and SRC, is the, not so much the standardisation, but that national approach to recovery communities. I am not taking away the agility and the flexibility that recovery communities need, because they're mostly grassroots, but we don't have a standard for EDPs to say, as part of your national specification, your treatment and recovery pathway, you need to have this, this, this and this, and that's what we're going to measure you on. So that's why it's really important. Again, we keep talking about treatment, really important, but we need to talk about moving people out of treatment to live fulfilling lives, so we need to think about the whole continuum of care. I hope that answers that, Ros.
It certainly does, and I'd be interested if anybody else has any comments on that. Nothing. Good.
Well, in terms of, when I suppose we have national organisations, I mean, SDF, SRC, Scottish Family Affected by Drugs and Alcohol, Alcohol Focus Scotland, these are all based in Edinburgh and Glasgow. So from a national point of view, being based in the northeast of Scotland, I feel that we do miss out on the representation, the engagement of national organisations. So I'm always advocating that we have local control over how we engage with people. I think as taxpayers, the people deserve that. The population deserves that. I think, you know, that from my perspective, national often means central belt. So I suppose it's that bit, ensuring that if there are national resources, national frameworks, etc., that there is that local flexibility. And it's not just distributing things equally. There has to be equity in it, in terms of, you know, that we've got hugely rural areas in our neighbouring local authority with pockets of deprivation. We've got a a large city with particular issues that are unique. And, you know, obviously a lot of the discussion today has been around Glasgow and the drug consumption room there. But there are equally other challenges and harms in other parts of Scotland that don't necessarily get the airtime that colleagues represent in terms of the work that they're interested in and involved in.
I understand that. Thank you very much indeed. And thank you. No more questions.
Okay, thanks very much. We're just sort of coming into the final part of our session. I don't know, Colette Stevenson, if you wanted to come in on anything around the...
sorry, just quickly, and absolutely fascinated by all your input today. You're probably aware that I have got my own lived experience of a family member who did take drugs and also lost his life to a heroin overdose as well. So I found it fascinating, but I've also found it really frustrating because there is a lot of jargon used, and at the heart of it, for a user and an addict, they just want that wraparound support. But in terms of the actual national specification, I'd like to know more about how lived experience and their families and any other sort of key partners, and I've worked with the Beacons before in South Lanarkshire, have been adequately included in that national specification. Because when I was involved with my brother, one of the things they used to say was, he's not hit rock bottom yet. You allowing them to stay with you, you're actually feeding his habit. It was some of the worst advice you ever got. And one of the things that my brother used to say was, the worst thing that could happen to him, that he had no family ever to turn to. So I'm just wondering if all of that lived experience and any family work as well, what has actually been carried out? And I'm going to ask Tracy first.
I mean, the phrase that I've heard time and time again is, you're colluding with his behaviour. You're colluding with their behaviour. So I completely understand and that resonates. So thanks for sharing that. One of the points of the National Commission organisations and the people around the table here is actually we press the government to make sure that lived experience voice is around the table. And I think we need to continue to do that. We're having the same discussions across justice and across mental health about how you get lived experience voices around the table that's representative and it's not tokenistic. So it's the same discussions we're having around a range of different policy areas. It can be done. It is being done. It takes time. It takes energy. And a real big bugbear, I'm going to share my bugbear, I hope you don't mind, but actually we're asking a lot of people with lived experience to come around the table, and we're asking them to do that for free. We're asking them to do that and volunteer on their own time to do that. So there's a value that we're placing on that lived experience. So I would like to see some traction around, if we're asking people to share their time, share their experiences, we should be valuing that time. That's a big, massive message for me to say, we value your lived experience. Not just come to two meetings, can we take all the information that you have and then we don't need to talk to you again. It needs to be embedded in the system. I don't think we're quite there yet, because it's difficult to do. And in the meantime, we're trying to save people's lives to get them into treatment. But I think we need to start turning in its head, Colette, and to really start, as the National Drugs Death Task Force said, it needs to be person-centred and not service-centric. Mm-hmm. We need to challenge ourselves in that. And I think we've all got a role to play in that. Mm-hmm.
Just wondering if Wes wants to come in.
Thank you. I think while there is definitely a place and lived experience voice at being at the table is really, really important, I think also it's really good and useful to be including the living experience voice. So the people that are trying to access support right here, right now, because the landscape is very different. I'm problematically used the substance for about 6 years. So the treatment landscape is different. The substances that are out there are quite different. I think we need to make sure that we offer people adequate kind of groundwork before including people, especially in strategic meetings or anything like that. I know I can often feel out of place at strategic meetings. So, you know, how must someone who's very, very new to the whole environment be feeling? So I think making sure that adequate support is there. I think we need to think about what we're asking for, what we want to hear from the people who we're inviting to these type of meetings and trying to get their input. Often they'll come out with things we might not want to hear, if that makes sense, and how well equipped are services or strategic boards ready for that? If they really, really want to do it, I think we need to be quite bold and brave in our approach to doing that, because sometimes the truth is it hits hard. And I know, you know, people have spoken about, I know people in forward facing roles are working really, really hard to try and help and support people. And sometimes, you know, people criticising that or critiquing that can be quite difficult. And I'll just echo the point Tracy made about paying people for their time, expertise and insight. You know, vouchers doesn't pay my mortgage. And we shouldn't be asking people to turn up and have that kind of input for free.
No further questions.
OK, thanks very much. I think we've covered a lot. I really appreciate your forbearance because we have gone quite a bit over time. So thank you very much to you all. I think that's been a very, very helpful session this morning. We were hoping to have the Minister for Drugs and Policy, Eleanor Whittam, join us for a second panel. But unfortunately she's very unwell and not able to attend the meeting this morning. So we wish her a speedy recovery. So on that note, that completes the public part of the meeting, and we'll just move into private session and have a very quick pause just to allow our panel to leave. Thanks very much. Thank you.